Kurt, executive director of Charleston Moves. Show of hands, anyone know what Charleston Moves is or does? Anyone? Some of you don't. Charleston Moves is a nonprofit advocacy organization that advocates for safer, saner streets in Charleston for walking and biking. We have a great city, but it's a pretty shitty place to walk and bike. And my friends that are here know that I love mornings, and I'm really, really too chipper in the morning, usually. I was up about 5 this morning, a little bit nervous today, but that's also kind of my wake-up time. So anyway, it's a pleasure to be here today. It's great to be at the Library Society. And my background, I'm an urban designer. I'm an urban planner. I'm also a shameless urbanist. By that, I mean, I think that cities are the pinnacle of human achievement. Cities work. Suburbs, small towns, rural places. They're kind of nice once in a while, but cities frickin' work. Those places don't. but some cities are world class, while others are kind of like, meh, yay, Cleveland, right? Michigan native, Ohio's terrible too. But fundamentally, when you say, what's the difference between a world class city and those only okay places? It's the quality of their public space. I should probably click over to my title slide. How else is your opinion of a city shaped other than the experience of walking or biking down a street? People drive long distances just to come to our street here, come to our center city here. They'll drive 1,000 miles to walk 6 in a weekend to enjoy Charleston. Our streets are historic, they're postcard pretty, but all too often we accommodate the car culture, the windshield experience over the human experience. I believe that it's time for a sane streets revolution here in Charleston, because for the last 50, 60, 70, 80 years, we've had an insane streets policy. So I ask you to join me today in kind of drinking the sane streets Kool-Aid, and because I believe that this really radical notion that none of us, any of us, should be maimed or killed using our streets at all. I know it's crazy. It's naive, perhaps. Take a look at King Street, 1902. There were about 70,000 people living downtown. People walked, they biked, and holy shit, they took transit, right? We all think, my goodness, we're going to get that light rail one day from Somerville to Charleston. No, we're not. No, we're not. No one's going to take it, and no one's going to pay $1 billion for it. Literally $1 billion. But we had this at one time. We now have 35,000 people on the peninsula. It's growing slightly. It's growing slowly. That number's going back up. But we used to be much more dense. People got around in different ways. Now we bitch about congestion, right? We don't have it that bad, but we're moving around in different ways. Our streets were once real public spaces, filled with human interaction. But by the middle of the 20th century, thanks to my hometown of Flint, Michigan, and Detroit, and all those Rust Belt cities that made cars, the streetcar was gone. Goodbye, human scale. Goodbye, walking, biking, transit. Hello, Carmageddon. But this persists today. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed on King Street, except for the cars are less bulbous, right? Those are pretty sweet, though, I gotta say. I don't hate cars, by the way. I really don't, but they're kind of useless tools in urban settings. Today, once a month, King Street returns to a sane place, right? You remove the cars, add the people. The top left photo, that's an everyday King Street shot. How many of those people are able to get out and get lunch or support the local vendors and the shops? None. They're stuck. But on second Sundays, pretty humane place to walk around, spend money, open your wallet. people dominate. But we're a world-class city, or we claim to be. Our 12 days a year, 12 out of 365, is that okay? I don't think so. How crazy has our cars first, people second, third, or fourth, maybe 10th, how crazy has that planning gotten? Well, crazy enough that we house cars instead of people. It's gotten to the point that driving is so incentivized by providing cheap or free parking that a person's private vehicle, it's okay to put that on the public right-of-way. Think about it, right? A car space is usually about 20 by 10, 200 square feet. Imagine the garden you could grow with 200 square feet. Or, let's say, a 200 square foot studio apartment. That's about the size they are in major mega cities. I'd love a small studio for free here in Charleston, but I don't have one. Imagine the killing you could make if you could put your free studio apartment that you've been given by the city of Charleston and by the county, if you put it on Airbnb illegally during Spoleto. you could charge $350 a night if it's south of Calhoun Street. I digress. But this begs the question, who are we building our cities for? Are we planning and building? Sorry, I'm looking at my notes. Really, really crazy party last night after Ride of Silence. Are we planning and building for residents, many of whom live within respectable distance, a comfortable range of their jobs, their schools, their grocery stores, their libraries, the tax base, those who pay taxes here in Charleston? Or are we building our cities, are we robbing their quality of life by building for those who drive in from 20, 30, 40 miles out, sweat under terrible fluorescent lighting all day, and leave at 5:01 p.m., taking their taxes with them? Who are we planning and building our cities for? Excuse me. But why does it matter? What does this mean? Well, here's some stats for it. It's 8:50. It's time for stats. Each year, 1.3 million people are killed globally by traffic violence. I don't say crashes, I don't say accidents, I say traffic violence because that's what it is. It's not an accident a lot of times. These things are preventable with better design. That's 10 Charlestons. That's the peninsula map from like way back when, plus one. That's 10 Charlestons. Looking at it another way, that's the population of Manhattan dying every year in our streets because traffic violence. In the US, we have about 35,000 fatalities annually from the same thing. That's a 9/11 every month. If George Bush were still president, we'd be, calling people terrorists for crashing into each other. He would be on the USS whatever that was saying mission accomplished way too early. That just happened. So I think this scenario is, kind of batshit crazy. It's crazy. We're the car emerged as a promise of freedom and independence, but now we're trapped by it. This is an actual shot recently of people, I guess, trying to go to the beach a few weekends ago. That's not Los Angeles, that's here. That's here in Charleston. And car dependence has led to sprawl in this scenario, and it's maybe counterintuitive, but no one has ever fixed congestion. You can't fix what you've pretty much ruined. You can't keep adding more asphalt, because all that does is add more cars to the road, especially when it's free. Call me crazy, but I don't see South Carolina putting up many toll roads or congestion pricing schemes or easy passes anytime soon. So we're not going to be able to build our way out of it. If aliens landed in Charleston, or most of the country, they may mistakenly think that we're asphalt farmers, right? But ignoring the fact that you can't magically solve traffic problems by continually building and building and building and building and widening streets and highways, we've gotten to this point. And longer commutes equal sad people equal fewer happy hours, right? But there is something we can do.
Bicycle, bicycle, bicycle.
to ride my bicycle. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride my bike. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride it where I like. You say black, I say white. You say black. Did you use the full thing? All right, I'll just go to the next piece here, but that's cool. Show of hands again, who biked here today? Sweet. That's fewer than I wanted. Raise your hand if you walked. Oh, you lucky 29401 people. Nice. You walked from 03? Heck yeah, you did. Okay, and if you drove, I won't judge too harshly. Raise your hand. Look at all those motorists. If you drove, last question, other than if you don't know how you got here, anyone forget how they got here? If you drove, would you have rather biked? Raise your hand. Why didn't you?
I live on Daniel Island.
Okay.
Crutches.
Someone else?
I was carpooling.
There you go. Cool. Well, the good thing is you're not alone. This is in the wrong order. There we go. You're not alone. Recent research in the U.S., this isn't Copenhagen, shows that full two-thirds of people in the U.S. are currently biking for everyday transportation or interested in it, right? But there are basically four types of people out there. Step one is the crazies, right? Less than 1% of the population rides every day. Less than 1% of the population thinks that, heck, I can ride in any situation. That's kind of like the bike messenger type, the fixie crowd. Or like the roadie types, the shaved leg dudes, you know? The worst ones are the mammals, which is an acronym for middle-aged man in Lycra. They're the worst. They're kind of the intrepid. They ride anywhere. They'll ride on any kind of street except for maybe an interstate, and heck, maybe an interstate if they could, if it's legal. But that's 1% of the population. 7% of the population is the enthusiastic and confident, right? So they're the ones who, they're citizen cyclists, that's what I call them. And they ride the calmer streets, the neighborhood streets, maybe St. Philip like the college kids, maybe the Battery here and there. They'll ride streets with few vehicles or slow speeds. But the real opportunity is that next arc there, that 60%. They're really interested, but rightfully so, they're concerned about safety. So the streets are unsafe, but how do we make them safer? How do we get that group, plus the 8% who already kind of ride, to use their bikes every day for transportation? Well, it's got to be planned for. It's got to be implemented quickly. You can't just have, maybe people will bike because it's green, or maybe people will bike because you can save money. Those things don't really work, right? So neither do share the road signs, especially the ones that you can't see on dangerous streets. So that's kind of like the Where's Waldo of Share the Road signs. That's on Washington Street behind some growth. And but that does not magically transform a street from unsafe to safe. The Share the Road sign stick plus prayer method doesn't work, right? But we've been doing that for a long time. What this is really good at, this is really, really, really good at keeping the number of bicyclists on the street to a bare minimum, right? Nobody wants to ride there. So more people would be more comfortable biking if speeds were lower. My recommendation, I know I'm crazy for thinking this, I've been told I'm crazy for thinking this, why the heck do you need to go any faster than 20 miles an hour on the peninsula? Blanket 20 mile an hour speed limit? That'd be pretty cool. Calm traffic, there's people out and about. That'd be a pretty smart thing to do. In Europe, every center city has a 30 km speed limit, that's 19 miles an hour. I'm not trying to say we're Europe, but there's nothing wrong with emulating that brilliance, really. And why is that, though? Why make it 20? Because of this. If you're hit by a vehicle, let's hope you're not. But if you are, let's hope to hell that it's very slow. Because if it's about 20 miles an hour, you have a 9 out of 10 chance of living through it. If you're struck at faster speeds, well, the numbers speak for themselves. And this, you may not be able to see it in the back, but that top vision cone is what we call it in planning schools. That top vision field is what the motorist sees at 15 miles per hour. You see both lanes of traffic, you see both sidewalks, you see the human beings, the trees. Below that is 30. You've probably seen where I'm going with this. You have less of a chance of seeing what's really happening next to the street, next to the throughway, if you're driving faster. We all know that unpredictable shit happens. When it does, when the six-year-old girl chases her soccer ball onto the street, or that adorable little puppy gets free from its leash, well, if you see that and you're going 15, you have a lot better chance of stopping and causing, you know, maybe some tire marks on the street as opposed to a fatality. All right, so making your street safer must cost money, right? It has to. Yes, you're absolutely right, but it's pennies on the dollar if you're smart about design. I'm a big fan of the lighter, cheaper, quicker model. I've designed streets and parks and plazas, subway stations around the country, mostly in New York City. But what was really fascinating about working and living in New York was there's budget constraints everywhere. But you can fix things with paint if it's well done. You can fix things with epoxy gravel, which is the spreadable stuff that's as cheap as paint. It's a different color than the pavement. I'm convinced there's no need for huge projects with bloated budgets to make our streets as safe as possible. You can even put plastic bollards in, planter boxes, movable tables and chairs. This is a great before and after in the Bronx. If you look at it, if you can see it from where you're sitting, the only thing that was done was a sidewalk was, or a crosswalk was striped, a couple bike chevrons were put in, and admittedly there were two curb installations. In New York, even with the very, very bloated union wage scale, this is about a $30,000 project. In Charleston, it's probably about 15 or 20. So these things can be done dirt cheap. We're not moving things. We're not moving storm drains. We're not moving curbs. The good thing is, riding a bike in Charleston fits into this model, right? This red circle, this is the peninsula. No offense to those who aren't on the peninsula. This is very peninsula-focused on purpose today. The red circle is a two-mile radius circle from the Mary Street Visitor Center, right? Anyone can live their life very car-light, dare I say, many car-free on the peninsula. But we don't think that's possible most of the time because in most places in the U.S., 9 out of 10 trips of under 2 miles are done in the car, right? It's kind of nuts. You know, it builds into all of our social issues, all of our you know, issues with health and all the things that are really killing us in this country. Imagine what you could do within 2 miles of where you live on your bike. I'll ask you to do that later. So excuses are pretty, when I hear excuses like, oh, biking's impossible. How do you get around? Don't you sweat a lot? Don't you smell terrible at work? Yes, I do. But you can make this work. This mother's taking her kids to school. This isn't Copenhagen. This isn't Paris. This isn't Portland. This is King Street. With a good backpack, with a good bike, you can do anything. Grocery shop, run errands, even take your cat to the vet. I know, it's the awe factor. We can have sane streets with simple changes that cost very little money. We're not, like I said, we're not moving storm drains, we're not moving curbs, but we must be smart and strategic when making decisions about where to put certain facilities, right? So, I couldn't help myself, I saw it online, I stole it. My organization, Charleston Moves, is currently working with the City of Charleston and its design division on a downtown bike plan. It's going to be immediately and phase implementable, but it's not just me and a couple planners sitting in a room. It's not Charleston Moves sitting in the room with Tim Keene, who is actually leaving. It's all from you. The data that we got from this was unreal. We were hoping to get maybe 1,000 people or 1,000 bike routes submitted online. We had 1,700 in 3 weeks. And we emulated Cambridge, Massachusetts outreach model, which was 99% online, wiki maps, mostly email, pretty simple stuff. They did the same thing about 3 years ago. We had the same population, about 130,000 people. They're much more dense. They're also surrounded by the city of Boston. They've implemented some of their changes because of this, because of that data. But they only had 350 responses. We have 1,300 responses. That's not, you know, a pat on the back, good job. That's a mandate for better streets in this city. So anyway, what do we learn? What do we put on the streets? That's the exciting part, right? That's what I like to do. The political stuff, all that, or, you know, fundraising. Ugh, I like design. That's what I like to do. Well-placed bike markings on the street reinforce the bicyclist's right to be on the street, as well as their proper lane position. This is in, I believe it's Seattle. This shows you should be in the middle of the lane. It's a neighborhood street. It's called a bike boulevard. That costs about $6 in paint to do. Maybe $1,000 if you get a big union style thing coming on in. But it's pretty easy to paint that on the street. I think we have some artists in here that would love to do this. But we're a little hamstrung with DOT regulations. This is good for slow, calm streets. And, you know, because we always hear, oh, those damn bicyclists running red lights, riding on the sidewalk, riding the wrong way. This is a literal user guide on the street. We always hear, well, can't you just tell those College of Charleston kids to ride better? Sure. Let a 19-year-old kid from Anderson, South Carolina listen to my, you know, old behind. They're not going to do that. But there's literally no user guide on the street. This can combat wrong-way riding and sidewalk riding. St. Philip Street, anyone? You're pretty cool. One step up from that is, we have a couple of these in town, is the conventional bike lane. It's pretty simple. They're 4 to 6 feet wide. You have issues with door zones and all that stuff. But it does demarcate space on the street. It does show where you should be, where the car shouldn't be. So, you know, they're useful. Visibility can be definitely enhanced if you paint it green or have some, you know, paint it through the intersection. One step up from that is the buffered bike lane. I like these a lot. This painted stripe on the side increases what is called the shy distance. They're about 1.5 feet, 2 feet wide, and gives more space between the car and the passing vehicle. And this, as you can probably tell, is not in some crazy, fantastical place like Copenhagen or New York City or Portland. That's in some little town in Indiana. So we can do that here. And those are good for streets about 30 miles an hour. But to really get people riding, and to get those 60% of people who aren't riding yet but are kind of concerned about it, love to, they'd be like, oh, it'd be great if I could ride to work, ride to school, ride to the grocery store safely. The protected bike lane is kind of the gold ticket. That's kind of the Willy Wonka thing, right? These are placed on streets exceeding 35 miles per hour with high traffic volumes. They can be one-way, they can be two-way. This one's two-way. The major difference, of course, is the level of protection the rider has. Bollards, jersey barriers, even parked vehicles that are floated away from the curb can act as the barrier. Pretty cool, right? This next slide, I love this one because that previous slide was in Brooklyn, blah, blah, blah. Everything's perfect there. It's not. Is Memphis, Tennessee. This upper shot before looks to me like Upper King Street. There's tons of space, right? It's underutilized. Below that is a rendering, a fairly crude one, of a protected bike lane using planters. How cool, kind of green, kind of digs up the stormwater, and it's pretty. That can transform a street. That's happening in Memphis right now. Memphis, Tennessee, not Brooklyn or Portland. So you kind of see where I'm going. We can do these things here. We can, and I argue, that we must get back to treating our streets as public spaces. They're not utilities like sewer lines. They're not water pipes. It's time to elevate our city planning and urban design, you know, beyond that failed one-dimensional vehicle-centric approach. When you get home this evening, look at your street. Is it used as like a cut-through to a highway or a bigger street? Is it a route motorists use to save time? Or is your street a place to spend time? Do you see people interacting, walking, talking to their neighbors, their friends, their kids? Do you see little kids playing stickball or whatever they call it today? can you buy a gallon of milk without burning a gallon of gas? Would you let your child, for the parents in here, would you let your child walk to the corner store to buy a candy bar and ice cream cone by themselves? That is a good marker of a good street and a good neighborhood. Diagnosing the problem and planning the solutions is kind of the fun and easy part. Ending the inertia and the acceptance of the status quo is the really tough part. All things having to do with sane streets, great streets, world-class streets, they're political issues. They're not fiscal issues. Don't let anyone tell you they are. And that's where the Creative Mornings teams can help out. I can't change the streets overnight. Charleston Moves can't do it either. We can't do it at all without your help, without advocates that help us push for these changes. So I ask you to do three things today. One, ride your bike. Are you nervous about it? Ride with someone who rides a lot now. See what you can bike to within a mile or two of your place. Just try it out. Pump the tires back up. Dust your bike off. Get out there. Two, I don't want to talk about my organization too much, but go to charlestonmoves.org and click get involved and sign up for our email list so you can stay up to date on what we're actually working on. We have a couple of asks on our site right now. And lastly, if you believe we can do better than what we have now outside in our streets, if we can have better places to walk and bike, then please sign, it's in the back, please sign our declaration for sane streets. And per period appropriateness, I have a quill. We're in the Library Society. So please sign that if you think we can have better streets for walking and biking in Charleston. Thank you.